morning. And welcome to the Lord's house for worship today. It's good to see everyone in person. I'd also like to take a moment to welcome those viewing today via the web stream, and we ask God's blessings upon you all as well. Just a few things quickly by way of announcement. Please make note of this week's schedule. We have deacons meeting tomorrow night. We have our in-person Bible studies on Wednesday at 10 and 6:30, as well as online. This week we'll be looking at the 14th chapter of Romans. And in just a few weeks, as we move into September, we'll begin a study on the book of Acts. Next Sunday, we will share in the Lord's Supper during our time of worship. Please make note under this and that, there are a couple of announcements, very important there. There will be a called meeting immediately following worship next Sunday, the 21st, to hear from our Board of Trustees concerning the clearing of the land that's adjacent to Heritage Hall, and also some much-needed roof repairs related to a storm earlier this summer. So please keep those two items of business in mind, and we will have a brief meeting right after worship next Sunday. We also still have need of a number of weekly sponsors for the lawn maintenance and the church housekeeping. The cost is $100 per week, and individuals or couples, families can go together to cover the amount of that, and the sign-up notebooks for those services as well as for altar flowers for worship can be found on the small table at the front of the conference room by the window. Marcy, is there anything you want to add about the insert? I know there's a lot of good things coming up in the fall.
Your insert today basically is talking about our Wednesday night program, or our Wednesday afternoon and Wednesday evening program for the fall. We have had it in parts through the past couple of years with COVID, but we are trying to get it back full swing starting the first Wednesday in September. And when I say full swing, that means kindergarten through 12th grade after school program, all four Wednesday night dinners, and kindergarten through 12th grade Wednesday night classes and activities. So that takes a lot of volunteers to be able to do that. So I have listed on there, on the back, I think it is, who all we need to be able to do that. It also lists on Sundays some of the volunteers that we have. Currently, we only have one elementary class that is in place, and we have a middle school class that is in place. But we need to break that elementary class into two classes, and we really need to have a preschool class as well. And we have not been able to have a nursery other than having parents or grandparents take their own children to the nursery since COVID has hit, and we really need to have that back in place as well. So all of those different positions plus some more are listed on your bulletin insert today, and we ask that you be in prayer and look over those positions and see the different opportunities that you have to volunteer, and prayerfully consider where you may be able to help in the ministry of this church to our children and to our families. And also those who have children and youth, let me know what if you'll be able to enroll your children in our after-school program, and if they're interested in coming on our Wednesday nights activities as well. I do have the paperwork ready, and we will be picking up from Lucama Elementary, Springfield, and Hunt this year. Children from other schools are welcome to attend, but they have to provide their own transportation. At this time, let us prepare our heart for worship.
Today.
Please stand and join us in the responsive call to worship. We come into the presence of the holy God,
who may not be grasped,
but may be gazed upon,
who is not easily understood,
but is full of understanding,
who does not come at our beck and call,
but who is always near.
We gather as God's children
in confident assurance that God is here.
Brother Patrick, would you offer
I do want to remind everyone that Trinity Circle's Parade of Tables is coming up in a couple weeks. There are a few tickets left, so if you are interested in going, you need to see me, Joyce and Allie, Pam Jenkins, Jennifer first, and they have some. I'm not sure about anybody else. But if you're interested in it, please, please see one of us as soon as possible because those tickets are going fast. Our song of celebration is He Keeps Me Singing, page 488.
Jesus, 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 save us, save our Lord.
The gospel lesson comes from John 14, verses 1 through 7. John chapter 14, verses 1 through 7. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may also be. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, do know him and have seen him. The word of the Lord, the word of God for people of God. Thanks be unto God.
We go to our Heavenly Father in prayer this morning. I call your attention to the back of the bulletin. You'll see many names reflected there within our church family and also throughout the community. Are there other names you would have us to include this morning? Diane?
Judy Boykin.
Judy Boykin. Ashley? All right. One of her clients having surgery this coming week. Anyone else? Miss Betty Jo?
Our neighbor, Christine Simpson.
Yes, the family of one of our original Free Will Baptist ministers who passed away as a result of a car accident. His wife was, I think, killed instantly, and then he passed away on Thursday evening. So do remember that family. Perhaps by uplifted hands. God sees each and every heart, and God understands the depths of our needs and hurts. Would you bow with me for a time of prayer? Those words from John 14 are so well known to us. Many times we hear them during a time of bereavement. But Lord, we need to be reminded of these words each and every day, not just during seasons of sadness or death. It should give us hope and encouragement to know that you have prepared a place beyond this life, beyond the present day aches and pains, frustrations and disappointments, hurts and tears. A place that we call heaven. A place where we can enjoy eternity in your presence, where we will be reunited with the saints who've gone on before us. Lord, thank you for the gift that is so very precious to us. It gives us something to anticipate, and for those of us in Christ, we know we do not fear the sting of death, for through the resurrection of your Son Jesus, death has been defeated once and for all. Lord, as we assemble today for worship, we thank you for your blessings, your strength, your goodness, your love, your peace, made known to us in many different expressions each and every day. We're so thankful that we can enter into your presence knowing that you hear us when we pray and that you understand our hurts through and through. Lord, today we lift up to you the names of all of those who've been mentioned verbally. A number of names are reported weekly on our prayer list, and still others are unspoken. We may not always understand the how and why of life, but we know that you are with us through the valleys. You will see us through difficulties. Lord, we ask that you would draw alongside of all of those who are hurting today, whether they be hospitalized, whether they're preparing for surgeries or recovering from procedures, whether they're wrestling not only physically but spiritually, emotionally, or mentally. We know that you are God through all times and places that we may experience. And we are so grateful that you hear us when we pray, that you take our needs close to your heart, and you see us through these moments. Lord, for this time together, again, we give you thanks and praise. And when we depart this house of worship, may we be eager and ready, enthusiastic about our faith, ready to go forth and serve, eager to serve others in the name of the resurrected Christ. And it's in his name that we do offer our prayer this day.
Thank you.
Please stand and join us in the affirmation of faith. Let us begin. We believe there is one living, true, and eternal God, the Father, in whom are all things, from everlasting to everlasting, glorious and unchangeable in all his attributes. We believe there is one Lord, Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, the only Son of God, born of the Virgin Mary, who was truly God and truly human. We believe there is one Holy Spirit, the precious gift of the Father through his Son, who is the divine presence in our lives. We believe that the church is the body of Christ, all believers everywhere. We believe in the general provision made of God in Christ for all who respond in total trust and commitment. We believe in the fellowship of the saints through the worshiping community and in the promise of life eternal. Amen. You may be seated, and the children may come with me to Junior Church.
Thank you, ma'am. Our sermon text for today is taken from Paul's letter to the believers in Corinth that we know as 1 Corinthians. This morning we'll be looking at the 15th chapter and verses 12 through 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verses, chapter 15 verses 12 through 19. Over these Sundays of summer, we've been considering some of the core beliefs that we have as Christians. Yes, Sunday after Sunday, we've used our original Free Will Baptist affirmation of faith. And that's kind of given us a template, a format, some guidance as to some of those fundamental things that we profess as original Free Will Baptists. We believe that there is a God. We believe that God is personal. We believe that God is holy. We believe that God has made God's self known to us through the sending of his Son. We believe God's Son is the Savior of humanity. We believe the Holy Spirit is God's gift to us, God's abiding presence within our lives. We believe the church is the body of Christ, all believers everywhere. We believe that God has made salvation known to anyone and everyone who will respond in faith and commitment. And today we finish out our series of sermons by focusing on what we believe about eternal life. May we give ear to the reading of Holy Scripture as found in Paul's words, as found in 1 Corinthians 15. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation has been in vain, and your faith has been in vain. For we are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified of God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it's true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are raised, then Christ has not yet been raised. If Christ has not yet been raised, your faith is futile and you're still in your sins. Then those who have died in Christ have perished. If for this only we have hoped in Christ, we are all people most to be pitied. Brothers and sisters, may God add a blessing to this, the reading, hearing, understanding, and living of these words for our days. Amen. Home. There's no place like home, Dorothy reminds us in The Wizard of Oz. A welcome mat says, there's no place like home. The choir sang just moments ago, this world is not my home, I'm just passing through. We have different ways of expressing home and what home means to each and every one of us. For home, it could be family. For home, some may be the dwelling place, the house in which they live. For some, home can be that eternal place that's been prepared for all of those who believe, those who will receive through Christ the salvation that's been made available. A good place, a place, as I prayed moments ago, where we will all one day be reunited with those loved ones, those saints in the faith who've gone on before us. I can't tell you how many times I've sat at a bedside, whether at a home, a hospice, a hospital, and heard words stating, "I just want to go home." And by that we know that a person, if his or her life is right with the Lord, if he or she is not dreading that time that we know as death, means that he or she is wanting to leave this life, a life characterized with aches and pains, disappointments and frustrations, to go and be with his or her Lord and Savior. Home. No place like it. We think we know a thing or two about home, people, the things that we enjoy about life upon this earth, but as we often say, they pale in comparison to what God has prepared for us. And for the Apostle Paul, he knew that to be true. He was convicted of that, and he longed to encourage the believers in Corinth that because of the resurrection, there is life, a different quality of life available. Essentially, it begins in the present, in the here and now, but it continues on with us even after we draw our final breath. Over and over, Paul in these words states that it's important that we believe in the resurrection of Christ. Because it's through the resurrection of Jesus that we know that we too one day will be resurrected as well. And we have one of two places that we can go when we leave this life. One where we'll be in God's eternal presence, where there are no more tears, there's no more suffering, there's no more anxiety, stress, anguish, hurt. And then there's the alternative to that. If we do not know Christ as our Lord and Savior, it is a place of darkness, a place of great separation from God for all of eternity. And as we talked about last Sunday, what God has made available to us through Jesus gives us access to that wonderful place, that beautiful place that Revelation speaks of, that Jesus spoke of in today's gospel reading, and that Paul mentions even as 1 Corinthians 15 continues to unfold. We could have read the entirety of this chapter because it prepares us for things that are yet to come. How is it that we focus on those things that are yet to come? We know without a shadow of doubt this life does not go on forever and ever. Some may live into their 80s like the Reverend Emmett Jones and his wife who passed away as a result of that car accident earlier this week. Some may pass away soon out of the womb. Some may be college students right at the prime of their life making career decisions focused on happy days to come, a future career and family. That couple of 69 years, like my grandparents a few years ago, have shared a good life together, but then my granddaddy was diagnosed with stomach cancer. And then about a year and a half later, my grandmother, who practically grieved herself to death, also went to be with the Lord. Those aren't things that we really like to think about. We don't like funerals. We don't like memorial services. We don't like any discussion about death. We don't like movies that end sad. But the reality is, death is something that we all must face. It's been said that death and taxes are the two certainties about this life, and we can't avoid taxes, can we? And someday in time, our Lord and Savior is going to come calling. Whether it's Christ returning for His church, or whether it's us drawing our final breath, this life on earth will come to a close. How is it that we face those things? Do we face them with fear, anxiety? Do we face them kicking and screaming? When we look at the world around us, people respond to topics such as this in many different ways. On your notes handout in your insert, I give you two different illustrations. A woman stands at the graveside of a close friend and says, "Well, this is it. Farewell." And then there's a gentleman who grieves the passing of his spouse and says, "Until we see each other again in God's eternity." Two very different ways of looking at what is to come, what life is like beyond the here and now. Some view life as a helpless end. Everything comes to a conclusion. We cease to exist. There is no more of who we are. We see that in a variety of religious movements around the world where the idea is all of your energy, all that makes you who you are, is essentially absorbed back into the universe. But when we think about that, it gives us kind of a cold feeling. Just trying to get out of life, trying to end this cycle of ongoing existence and being absorbed into the universe. But for those of us who are in Christ, we know that it's not a final farewell. It's not an end to ends as we think about it. It may be a conclusion to this life as we know it in the present. But because of what Christ has done, not just in dying for the sins of humanity, but ultimately being resurrected from the grave, you and I possess a tremendous hope. But Paul does say a few things about it. He says, one, if Christ isn't resurrected, then there's not a whole lot to anticipate. It means that the gospel is all a fake. Everything that they've been teaching and preaching has been a fraud to this point. But if Christ has been raised, that puts things in a whole different light, because it's not only the fact that Christ has been resurrected from the dead, it also means that when our time draws to a conclusion, we will be in God's eternal presence. I believe there are a few things that Paul encourages us with when we read not only the few select verses today from 1 Corinthians 15, but really if you read the entirety of chapter 15. It goes on to talk about our spiritual body and how these bodies may break down, but God has something prepared much different than this present body that's prone to aches and pains and surgeries and needs for medication. One of the first things that Paul encourages us with is the fact that we need to be ready. We need to be ready for whenever this life comes to its conclusion. That could be today, could be 50 years from now, but none of us know. We live each day by the grace of God, one moment at a time, one step at a time. We're at God's mercy for life and breath and existence each and every day. And we know that we have a certain amount of time on this earth, a certain amount of time in which we're able to make a difference. As I conversed with a parishioner early this past week, it reminded me of that hourglass that you see there on the screen. The sands begin to trickle down day by day by day, and no one has successfully grabbed hold of the sand and pushed it back up into the top of the hourglass. The same can be said for our lives. We cannot reclaim anything that's already been. We can merely focus on our tomorrows and making those tomorrows count as God gives us life and breath, letting our lives be who we should be for the sake of God's kingdom. Letting our lives count for something other than simply getting by, trying to pay the bills, trying to get to retirement, trying to pass time until Jesus returns or we die. It's as I shared in an illustration this past Wednesday with our Bible study group, and I've used this illustration before, but it was a little book that came out some years ago. It was a thank you gift for the bridge builders at the University of Mount Olive. It was the most ridiculous thing I had ever heard of, but the book was entitled Teach Me How to Die. I'm like, that's just morbid. That's ridiculous. Who in the world wants to read a book on how do I need to learn how to die? But then I actually started to look into it and began to read it, and I've become familiar with some other resources very similar to that little booklet. And the premise behind the author's writing was this: if you teach a person how to die well, they will discover a whole lot of what it means to live well. And that's what God wants us to do, is to make the most of our moments. And when we think about things from an eternal perspective, we realize just how limited this life is. I remember my great-grandmother living up into her 90s and thinking, wow, that's ancient. But then she would tell you the time had flown by. I look at the last almost 25 years of my life since high school, and I wonder, where did the time go? My parents and grandparents, teachers always told me as a child, never wish your life away. You'll want to reclaim that time, and how I wish it was true. How I wish I could put on the brakes, slow down this crazy life that we live, and savor the time a little bit more. But as I grow older, it seems like the time begins to pick up pace. And when we think about this life, whether it be a few years or upward of 100 years or even more, I saw of a lady who had turned 107 here in the past few weeks. Compared to eternity, it's minuscule. It's minuscule. It's teeny tiny. It's as though we pull in a rope, and I've used this illustration before. And it was 50 feet of rope. It went from the pulpit back toward my office, and I had taped off the first 3 or 4 inches of the rope. 3 or 4 inches taped off is an indication of what 80 to 100 years on this earth looks like compared to eternity. And if I could have afforded more, that rope would have just kept going and going. It could have gone all the way down to the intersection. Because that's how our lives compare with eternity. And when we think about there being an eternity, it should shape how we live our present days. What we do with our time, how we live out our Christian beliefs and values, we should realize that time is of the essence. Our lives are limited. Make a difference while we still can. A second thing that the Apostle Paul reminds us when we think about eternal matters and what God has prepared for us is the fact that we can walk through death and even difficulty knowing God is with us. It's the same assurance of the psalmist: yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. We find that same assurance from the Apostle Paul to the believers in Corinth. Death does not have to be the final say. It does not have to be a farewell. It does not have to be something that we look at with dread through Jesus Christ. We're able to see it as a door from one life to the next, where when we breathe our final on this earth, we draw our first breath in God's eternity. To think that God should prepare a place like that for us and to walk with us hand in hand, heart to heart, through our final moments on this earth, to call us home, to hear those words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." That's what we all long to hear. We think of so many other precious saints who've gone on to that eternal reward and to experience what we long to experience, I believe, is beyond human understanding. I believe it's beyond any kind of human words that we put to anything. We think we know beauty. We think we know perfection. It still pales in comparison compared to what God has prepared for us. How is it that we face death? How is it we face those late in life issues or maybe difficulties in general? Because we know that life does have its share of hurts, its share of pains, its share of stresses. There are days when we just don't even want to get out of the bed because it's another day filled with doubt and uncertainty. But God longs to be with us through these dark and difficult times. And that's one of the great truths that's come about through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. We're able to look at things and face things in a different way. We may not enjoy them, we may not celebrate them with smiles and backflips, but we're able to face them knowing that God will see us through. God will do, as that song says, take our hand and lead us home. A third point the Apostle Paul gives us, I believe, is this. It supplies us with comfort knowing that God is going to heal all things. God is going to restore all things. It's one of the beautiful things about the closing portion of Revelation, where it talks about there'll be no more tears. There'll be no more pain. There'll be no more suffering. God will make all things new, as the Scriptures teach. This life is not always the way we dream for it to be, is it? Oftentimes we have big visions and plans and goals and ambitions, and then we look back later in life and we wonder just what happened to those goals and dreams and ambitions. Life didn't work out the way we had planned it, the way we wrote it down, the way we longed for it to be. But we know that a time is coming, a day is coming, when God will make everything right, when God will heal all things, when God will take away all of the diseases, all of the cancers, all of the heart problems, all of the mental conditions, all of those things that weigh people down and burden families and bring anxiety and stress day after day after day. God's going to make all of that go away. It's beautiful to think that God is doing such a thing and preparing such a place for us even now, even as we worship this morning, even as we seek to live out our faith in these days. And the reason that we're able to anticipate that is because of the resurrection. One day you and I will have a body that cannot break down, that's not going to be prone to some of the conditions on this earth. I look forward to that day. I look forward to the day when my knees don't pop at 43. I look forward to seeing my grandparents. I look forward to seeing some of those heroes of my faith journey who passed away, as I would say, long before they should have. I look forward to that day when I don't have to hear of another sickness or another death or another broken scenario within a family.
That should give all of us hope and encouragement to know that this life is not the end of all things. If we're in Christ, we have a place prepared for us. We have the reassurance that we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever, as the psalmist says. I'm reminded of an illustration, a simple story that came out some years ago. I actually heard it again on Christian radio a few days ago. And it was talking about a lady and a special request she had for that time when she passed away. She said she wanted to be buried with a fork in her hand, and the minister thought it was a rather unusual request. He had heard a lot of things. Of course, he was all about trying to honor a person's wishes. And he inquired why it was that she wanted a fork of all objects that she could take with her. She told the minister, "You see, it's very simple. I think of eternal life and heaven a lot like dessert. Think about going to a place and having dinner, someone's house, at a party. And when you finish a wonderful meal, a lot of times someone will say, 'Hold on to your fork,' because you know that dessert's coming. And we often say that dessert is the best part of the meal. I think about the words of the author Adam Hamilton in his book 24 Hours That Changed the World. He shares an example from his own ministry. He said he had a gentleman that was all eager to hear about the gospel of Christ and all the things that he was able to explain about the life and the ministry of Jesus, the significance of all of that for our salvation. And Adam says that at the close of the conversation, the man wanted to know, very point blank and honest, "Let's get real, Adam. There's no cameras around. This isn't about writing books. Just get real with me for a moment." I said, "Adam, do you really believe all of that?" Adam said, "I looked at the gentleman and said, 'Not only do I believe all of it, I'm also staking my life on it.'" There are a lot of things about death and end of life and eternity that we don't really understand, that we can't fully grasp, that we can't try to make sense of, because none of us has died, lived eternal life for a few years, and come back to explain what that's all about. But I believe if what Paul says to the believers in Corinth, what the scriptures witness to elsewhere, if that is true, we can't even begin to imagine what God has in store for us. I close with an illustration from my own life and ministry. And I'm sure Dee will testify to this, as will Marcy and others who've been ministers of the gospel. Death is never anything that we look forward to. Over the years, we've had a lot of experience working together to celebrate the lives of so many precious saints, men and women of all ages, family backgrounds, and circumstances. And sometimes it's easy when you're ministering to a family during a time of sadness just to get into the ritual of it. You've done enough funerals, you've seen enough things time after time after time. But I remember, and this is full transparency from your pastor this morning, most of my life, I grew up without a lot of death close to my family. Sometimes an elderly person within my home church, but we never really went to the funerals. Then I became a minister, and those became some of the first funerals I ever attended in person. But even then, it was distant. It was people in the congregation who I had just started to get to know. But then the longer I stayed in my former ministry, the more challenging those funerals became. And I can say the same thing about ministry here at Little Rock. At first, I didn't really know the people that well, but now, after six, having just started my seventh year in the past 2 weeks, these funerals are becoming more and more complicated, because I know the people, I know the stories, I know the history. But even though I'm a minister of the gospel, I'll never forget, death never really touched me the same way until I started to experience family members. And I remember a conversation with my granddaddy back in the fall of 2015. He was there in the bed at my grandparents' house, and he wasn't able to really do anything for himself. I had to get the urinal for him and do some of those little untidy things that we often don't like to think about. And certainly as a grandchild, we don't want to have to do, but we do it because we love a person. Here I am, a senior pastor, and I look at my granddaddy and I say, is all this real? Not is it real that you're dying, but I know what you're talking about, that there's a place that's beautiful and that you're ready to go when Jesus calls your name. But I've got to know, is this real? And I'll never forget his response. He said, absolutely, it's real. You can't even begin to imagine it, Kelly. And for me, in that moment, it solidified a lot of things that I believe about life, but it also gave me a better understanding and appreciation of death and what happens in those final moments. Today, if you're in Christ, you have no need to fear death. You have no need to fear anything that this life may throw your way, because God is already victorious. And God has a place awaiting you that will bring full healing and restoration to your life. If you do not know Jesus Christ today as your Savior and Lord, this gift of God's grace can be yours absolutely free. There's no gimmicks, there are no strings attached. We come on faith and say, I need what God has done for me through the giving of His Son Jesus. I need that salvation in my life for this present living, but ultimately I also need it for where I want to spend eternity. Today this altar is open. If you've never made that profession of faith, will you come? Maybe you would like to recommit your life to following Christ and being the servant that God longs for you to be wherever God may use you in this life. Perhaps there are needs that are pressing upon your hearts and minds, your families, or even praiseworthy items you wish to come and give thanks for and celebrate with your Heavenly Father. This morning, no matter the need, no matter the condition of your heart, this altar is open as we prepare to stand and sing our hymn of commitment, number 543, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. Will we respond as God's Spirit is speaking?
Thank you.
brothers and sisters, it's been good to be with you today in the house of our Lord and Savior. As we go forth into this world, into our mission field, may we go with hope and strength, joy and courage, knowing that God is with us. And just as Christ has overcome death and the grave, He will see us through. He will help us overcome any number of things that we face on this side of heaven. May that guide us as we leave this place of worship, as we go forth to be the hands and feet of Jesus in the days to come. Would you bow with me for our benediction and the blessing of today's offering? Heavenly Father, for the gift of eternal life and the promise of the resurrection of the body, we give you thanks and praise. Lord, we never know when our time is going to come. But Lord, you've called us to be prepared. And because of our relationship with you through your Son, Jesus, we know that there's a beautiful place awaiting us when we'll be reunited with our loved ones and we'll be able to worship you and celebrate your glory forever and ever. Lord, that is good news. It gives us hope and strength for the living of these present days, and it also gives us a message that we should live and that we should speak of to the world around us. Be with us now as we go our separate ways. Lead, guide, and direct us according to your will and your purposes. And Lord, also we ask that you would bless these tithes and offerings, multiply them for the ongoing ministry of your kingdom here upon earth. In Jesus' name. Amen. Go in peace.